The Red Tsar. From inside the Kremlin, Stalin builds a cult of personality. Stalin and other members of the Politburo rarely traveled to the countryside to face the harsh consequences of their decisions. They ruled from their headquarters inside the Kremlin, a fortress in the heart of Moscow. Soviet leaders kept apartments in the Kremlin's Potemkin Palace, a short walk from their offices. Almost daily, they dropped by each other's homes for a visit. They ate dinner and went to movies together. On days off, they took family trips to their dachas, or country homes. They even vacationed together at resorts along the Black Sea coast. In the early 1930s, Stalin and his fellow Politburo members resembled a big family, a mob family. Stalin, the party's general secretary, was the big boss. He was an extremely hard worker who demanded the same dedication from the rest of his circle. On a typical day, he rose in the late morning and worked his way through stacks of government papers, puffing on his pipe and marking decisions in red and blue pencil. He rarely dressed in anything fancier than his usual military-style shirt, riding pants, and soft leather boots. In the mid-afternoon, Stalin often had a big meal with family and friends. The gathering of comrades usually included his wife Nadia and their two children, Vasily and Svetlana, as well as Yakov, his son from his first marriage. Stalin enjoyed horsing around with the kids. On occasion, he would wad up balls of bread to toss at companions or plunk into their drinks. After the late lunch and perhaps a nap, he returned to the office to continue his work late into the night. While he lived a relatively ordinary life in private, a different, almost superhuman image of Stalin was growing beyond the Kremlin walls. Official propaganda constantly reminded the Soviet people of Stalin's supposedly tireless devotion to the country. His picture often appeared on the front page of the official Soviet newspaper, Pravda, as he presented medals to the hardest working miners or milkmaids. Stalin's life is our life, our beautiful present and future, Pravda proclaimed. Kids in the Young Pioneers, the Soviet version of the Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts, appeared on posters above the slogan, "Thank you, Comrade Stalin, for our happy childhood." The party tightly controlled the way its leader was portrayed in the media. Cartoons of Stalin were forbidden in newspapers and magazines. Instead, paintings and photos showed him looking wisely into the distance, as if planning the nation's future. He always appeared in simple clothes to make himself look like a man of the people. Stalin was building a cult of personality, a heroic public image that encouraged people to idolize him without thinking critically about his policies. This hero worship served an important purpose. First of all, it kept Stalin in power. To many people, Comrade Stalin was the Soviet Revolution. Without him, they believed, the nation would fall apart. Stalin's cult of personality also bound the Soviet people to the state. Citizens who revered their leader were more likely to remain loyal to the government and follow its policies without objection. Publicly, Stalin liked to be seen as a humble leader, but he understood all too well the value of being worshipped like a god. In 1935, Stalin, his children, and some friends paid a surprise visit to the newly opened Metro, Moscow's subway. Surprised commuters pressed in to get a glimpse of their leader and shout compliments. Afterward, he described how much he had enjoyed the outing. He was inspired by the spontaneous love of the people for their leader, he told a friend. The people need a czar whom they can worship and for whom they can live and work. The man who had helped to overthrow the last czar now claimed that role for himself.